Good morning and welcome to our worship from Christchurch, Warwick, here in Bermuda. And a warm welcome to all joining us for this service, and best wishes to you all for this new year. Last year was undoubtedly a difficult and a challenging year for many. And so our hopes for this year, with the hopeful coming of the new vaccines, will result in a better year and a return eventually to some sort of normality, although things may always be somewhat different from what we've been used to in the past. We had thought this Sunday morning, this first Sunday, within our worship, to especially remember all those whom we have lost in the past year, through illness, some through COVID, here in our congregation and beyond. It was the intention, of course, that we'd be worshipping here in church. And so the thought has been that rather than have that bereavement service, or part of that bereavement in our service and our worship today, that we would postpone that to a later date when we can, in fact, gather here in this sanctuary for worship and properly remember with thanksgiving those whom we have loved and whom we have lost this past year. For this year, for the first Sunday of the year, we reflect on the theme of Epiphany, the journeying of the wise men, the Magi, to Bethlehem, the manifestation of Christ to indeed the whole world. And so let us worship God and sing to his praise, hymn 325, Bethlehem, a noble city, has been blessed beyond compare. On you the Lord shines, and over you his glory will appear. Nations will journey to your light, and kings to your radiance. Let us pray. Almighty God, we gather on this, the first Sunday of a new year, to offer you our worship and our praise, to acknowledge you as creator and sustainer of all, who creates this new year with all our hopes and ambitions for what may lie ahead. We gather this day, not here in this sanctuary together, but in our own homes, on our own, or as couples, or as families. And we gather not only friends and members of the congregation here in Bermuda, but thankfully joined by others from other nations of the world. We gather with a sense of thanksgiving For while this sanctuary may be almost empty, a place where people have worshipped down through the generations and the centuries, we are reminded that the church is your people, our own people of this congregation, of congregations of the island, your church in the world. And while we may not gather together for worship, we still reflect a unity of purpose in seeking to live in your ways, prompted in recent days and prompted for the days ahead by the gift of your Holy Spirit, seeking to guide us always in the ways of truth and of life, at times coming to us to heal, to comfort, to console, at other times in our midst, to prompt us, to challenge us, to better live in your ways. And so for the year ahead, we commit ourselves to live in those ways, for we confess we have not always done so. But we pray that through forgiveness may we leave behind the faults and the failings of the past year and the past years, and this day and this year be a new beginning. And so grant us, we pray, the assurance of your forgiveness, as we ask also the forgiveness and indeed the patience of those whom we have let down by our words and by our actions. Help us to leave these faults and failings and guilt behind. Help us to discern your presence in our midst, to hear again what it is you ask of each one of us, as individuals, as a community, to be your church in your world today. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The traditional reading for Epiphany Sunday, or Epiphany Day, is the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 2, and at verse 1, the visit of the wise men. Hear the word of God. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the king who has been born king of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word, so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. May God bless to us the reading of his word, and to his name be the praise and the glory. Amen. The anthem, "Mary, Did You Know?" Let us pray. May the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The journey of the wise men, the Magi, men from the east. Well, from where did they come? Well, it's likely that if you were a Christian living in the first or second century in Rome, you would think of the East as being Persia, and the wise men, the Magi, coming from there. In Greek literature, the word itself is a reference to Babylonia or Parthia. However, if you were a Palestinian Christian living in the first century, from the East would mean something quite different. It would in all likelihood mean east of the River Jordan, and of Jordan itself and the wilderness stretching into Arabia. And it's highly likely that indeed these Magi or wise men did come from Arabia. And the sense is confirmation of that, as well as the writings of some of the early church fathers who made that assumption. In 1920, a British scholar visited a group of Bedouins in Jordan. And this Muslim tribe were known by the Arabic name Al-Kokabani. Kokab meaning planet, and Al-Kokabani simply meaning those who study or follow the planets. And when this scholar, Bishop, asked the Bedouin why they had that name, they said that their ancestors had travelled to Palestine to pay homage and to welcome the great prophet that had been born. So an intriguing, perhaps interesting story, but what does it say to us, or what is its relevance for our reflection on the journeying of the wise men to visit the infant Jesus? Well, we really need to return to the scriptures of the Old Testament, and above all to the prophet Isaiah, which would be the Old Testament reading for today. Reflect on these opening verses of chapter 60. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. We need to remember that in the history of the countries of Israel and Judah, they had the misfortune of occupying that piece of land between the great kingdoms or empires of Egypt to the south, of Babylon and Persia and Assyria to the north, and throughout their history, found in the wars waged by these great empires, their sons and their daughters been taken off captive in slavery to live in strange lands. Israel, Judah, small nations, and caught in the midst of great and powerful empires, and all that that meant for their suffering and their occupation. But the prophet goes on with a great hope. Lift up your eyes and look around. Your sons shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be carried on their nurse's arms. Then you shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall thrill and rejoice. And further, the wealth of the nations shall come to you. A multitude of camels shall cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah. All those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense and shall proclaim the praise of the Lord. It's quite clear that the gospel writers, Luke and Matthew, would have known of Isaiah's prophecies of the time and the hope would come when Israel, Judah, would be freed from the oppression of their powerful neighbors and would be a land of great wealth and prosperity to which kings and nations and others would come bearing gifts and reflecting on the light. But when the prophet writes, "Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you," who is the you? To whom exactly does the prophet apply this? And of course, again, when we look at the history, it is to Jerusalem itself, and the prophet's hope that one day Jerusalem would indeed be the prime city in a great nation to which others would come for wisdom, for learning, and bringing great gifts, and Israel, Judah would indeed be a light to all the nations. The gifts of gold and frankincense from Midian and Ephah and Sheba, all parts of north and southern Arabia. Of course, it didn't happen. There were no kings and nations making their way to Jerusalem to marvel at its splendor. In the centuries before Jesus' birth, the city gates and walls were often closed not only at night but during the day. Such was the conflict around them. No, it didn't happen. And when, of course, we reflect on the times that the gospel writers were putting together their gospels, Jerusalem, far from being a light to the nations, had been ransacked, had been destroyed, the temple included. No, it didn't happen. So what's behind the gospel writers, and especially this gospel of Matthew, as he refers to the wise men, the magi, coming to pay homage? Well, it's not to the city. It's to the child. The wise men come to the child. The shepherds come not to the city. They come to the child. And we are reflected in our own time to come to the child. Yes, Jerusalem quite rightly is a place of great pilgrimage, a place of homage, and yet sadly a place of great conflict and tension over which wars have been waged down through the centuries and blood spilt to a horrible degree. So the story of Epiphany, Christ coming into our world, is a coming not to a city, but to a child. And a child whose presence cannot be found simply in the one place, but is to be found indeed in all of creation, in the places where we might look and the places where we might surprise us. Perhaps summed up in a poem well known in Ireland, the poem "I See His Blood Upon the Rose" by Joseph Plunkett. I see his blood upon the rose, and in the stars, the glory of his eyes. His body gleams amid eternal snows, his tears fall from the skies. I see his face in every flower, the thunder and the singing of the birds are but his voice. And carven by his power, rocks are his written words. All pathways by his feet are worn. His strong heart stirs the ever-beating sea. His crown of thorns is twined with every thorn. His cross is every tree. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We offer now our prayers of thanksgiving and our prayers for others. Let us pray. Almighty God, for all your gifts and blessings to us in years past, and for your continued presence with us, constant throughout our lives, we give you thanks. We thank you for that warm love that sustains all of creation. The darkness of the furthest galaxies, the light and the beauty of this planet on which we live, our island life here, surrounded by the wonder, the majesty of the great oceans. We give thanks too for the love that sustains us through the love of family and friends, for the support that we receive in our daily work and life, and which carries us into this new year. And we give thanks for the privilege of being called to serve within your church, to be a light within our own community, to seek to be of service, especially to others in their need. And through the promptings of your Spirit, to be able to discern your presence in our lives and in this your world. A healing presence with us in times of sorrow and sadness. A comforting presence in times of anxiety and need. And a presence too which stirs our consciences that we may not rest until we face the injustices in our midst, and the greater injustices in this your world. We give thanks above all for your face revealed in the Christ child and in the life of Christ, in whose name we offer now our prayers for others. We pray for our own families and friends, wherever they have started this new year, that this year may be a year in which they know and find your blessing and your peace. For those who look forward with anticipation to times of celebration, for those who are struggling with family relationships. We pray too for members of our own congregation. Although we may not be able to come together in worship, we are bound in unity, common purpose. But we pray especially for those who have grown frail and are cared for now in our nursing and residential homes. We offer our prayers for those whom this season has been a time tinged with sadness through the loss of loved ones. And remember all those who have lost loved ones in this past year, through the COVID virus or through other causes, and for whom this time has been a time of sense of absence and the missing of loved ones. May they be touched by your Holy Spirit. There are others too who are anxious or weary, those who are worried because of financial and economic situations, those who have lost employment. As we look to the year ahead, we pray there may be a betterment, that those who have lost work may in time be able to return to it and so care for their homes and for their families. And again, at the beginning of this new year, we pray for the leaders of the nations, that their hopes, that their ambitions, that their policies may be in accord with the vision of your kingdom. A kingdom of justice and righteousness, of peace and reconciliation, with an abiding concern for the most vulnerable, whether young or old, for those who languish as refugees caught up in war and violence, for those who struggle with poverty and hunger in the midst of plenty. We pray for your church, for the life of this congregation as individuals and as together, and for your church in the world, here to show how we might better live together. And always we remember with thanksgiving those no longer with us, but whose love we have known. May we never think them far from us, for we share a fellowship, a communion with them still, through the mystery of that fellowship and communion that we have with you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hymn 327. Brightest and best of the sons of the morning, dawn on our darkness and lend us thine aid.
Darkness, then lend us thine ear.
And now go in peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and all whom you love, this day and always. Amen.